Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome y'all to the Thursday, November the 10th, Alcohol Board, Beverage Board meeting. I'd like to start off by introducing our panel. My name is Linda Palczynski. I am Vice Chair, sitting in for our Chair, Ted Bellavine. To my right is Corporal James Stone, who's our alcohol coordinator, our attorney, James Tavenich, Tammy Hildebrand, who's our board administrator, Leonard Cole, member. To my left is Kevin Hall, member, and Betty Curry, member. And we also have Susan Wilden, who is our administrative assistant. Today, we're going to start off with the approval of the minutes for October the 13th, 2016. May I have a motion for approval?
I make a motion to approve the minutes for the Alcohol Beverage Board meeting for Thursday, October 13th, 2016.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay, minutes approved.
Nope.
Vote.
Oh, we need to take a vote, please. All in favor?
Aye.
Those in non-favor. Okay, motion passed, approval of minutes. Okay. First on our agenda today is a Responsible Alcohol Retailers Award ceremony, please. Say your name, please.
Yeah, I'm Lauren Abel. I'm the program coordinator for the Canadian Alcohol Coalition. Those of you that don't know me. So today, the Licensed Beverage Association and the grant program, Canadian Alcohol Coalition, would like to recognize you all that for being responsible business owners in our community. You guys do have a piece in this puzzle of keeping community members safe and ensuring that everyone is drinking responsibly and practicing responsible behavior. So we do appreciate you guys doing that, so that's why we have rewards for you today. If you please, when I call your business name, if your representative could come up, collect the award, return to your seat, and then afterwards we're going to take a group photo, okay? So first up is ABC Liquors. American Legion Post 255, right here, okay. Bay Country Liquors, Buzzy's Country Store, California Wine and Spirits, Canopy Liquors, Captain Leonard Seafood. Thank you. Captain Pat's Seafood Market, Chapsico Market, Pulse Point Tavern, Country Liquors, The Crystal Room, Elks Lodge 2092, Return Order Police Lodge number 7, International Beverage Cadillac Jacks. Corner Carry Out, Moose Lodge 495, Old Breton Inn, Old Town Pub. Thank you. Racing In. Salsa's Mexican Cafe. San Jason. Seabreeze Restaurant. St. Mary's Landing. The Rex. Toots Bar. Vino to Wine and Liquors. And Wildwood Wine and Spirits. Okay, thank you. So just to explain a little bit more about the award, the Community Alcohol Coalition, within partnership of the Licensed Beverage Association, decided to recognize those who, like I mentioned before, are being responsible in their business practices and haven't received any violations for the 2015 year. Last 3 years. So we just want to recognize you all for doing a great job. It's always good to be recognized for good work. So we appreciate that. So with your award, you also received a window cling on the back. We ask that if you would like to please display that at your business so community members can know that you are responsible business practice, right? So we have everyone come up.
Can the board, would the board please go up?
And stand behind them.
Yeah.
Thank you all.
Shall we come back here or?
Wherever, ask the photographer.
You guys can move up a little bit further forward right here, and then you guys slide in from behind. Okay. If you guys are bunched up in the corner. It's the first time we're wearing a mustache. Hopefully, I don't make everyone feel comfortable right now.
Is that mic in your way, Jimmy?
But I think you're going to make you guys smile. So.
Jimmy, is that mic in your way?
No, the mic's good.
Picture?
Yeah, it's perfect. Awesome, guys. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, congratulations to everybody. That's very nice. Before we get started, we also have another board member, Garland Thompson, who's our inspector. That completes our board. Okay, we're going to start today with old business, extensions of conditional approvals. Number one, first one is Hacienda Los Gallegos, Maria Roos. Request an extension of conditional approval. Can you please step forward?
I do not see Ms. Ruiz. Susie, can you try and give her a call? Thank you. If you want to table that for now?
Yes. Okay. Not here. We'll table this one.
Just till later. We'll see if she can get a hold of it.
Yeah, unless she arrives, we'll put it on. Yes. The next one is Patuxent or Pax River Ale House, Melissa Akris and Jane Carroll. Request an extension of conditional approval. Hello? Step up to the microphone. And
please step up to the microphone, please. Raise your right hand. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, please state your name and address.
It's Melissa Michelle Akaris, and my address is 4704 Harvard Road, College Park, Maryland, 20740.
This?
Melissa.
Yeah, so I thought. Okay, hon, come on and have a seat. Okay.
And I was, Ms. Carroll did call me. She has home issues that she couldn't come to the meeting, but did she give you her letter?
She did. I do have it on my email. I apologize. I didn't print that up.
Okay, please get that to us.
I
can verify. I spoke with Ms. Carroll, and she did give Melissa permission to speak on her behalf.
Okay. All right. Tell us a little about what's going on, please.
So we are so close. We are so close. We actually got our health department permit and our fire marshal's permit. So today, just before I drove off the lot at the ale house, the Metrocom was coming to give us our last sign-off for a valve that we needed to fix. And the building inspector requested that we do something with our sign. And so that's the last thing on that. So by the end of next week, we should have all of our permitting finished. Almost there.
Almost.
Yes.
How long of extension are you asking for?
30 days, please.
Well, it'd be 30 days, right? Okay.
What's pending, Linda?
30 days.
You don't need to do a pending. You've done that with the original application, so she's just asking for more time.
They have the health department approval and fire marshal right now.
No pending of receipt of her letter to you?
No. I've already been, that'll come to me. I'm not worried about that.
Any questions or discussions on that? Okay. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the extension of conditional approval for 30 days for Pax River Ale House, Melissa Akaras and Jane Carroll, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Opposed? Okay. Good luck. Hope you open within 30 days.
I will be. I'm so excited. Okay. Thank you.
Stuff to me, Melissa, next week. Okay. We'll be closed tomorrow for the holiday.
All right. Thank you. Enjoy your weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on our list is Village Liquors, Nalani H. Viada, and Joseph W. Fender. Oh, excuse me.
Oh. Okay, hang on. Okay.
Excuse me, please.
I swear I'm in.
Is that Hacienda?
Yes, Hacienda just walked in. It's up to you how you want to go.
Okay. Can you raise your right hand, please? Okay. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
Okay. Please step up to the mic individually, state your full name and address, please.
Nalini Hammond Vaidya.
I'm sorry?
Step a little closer to the microphone, please.
Nalini Hammond Vaidya. Address is 10870 Crane Highway, Faulkner, Maryland, 20632.
Okay.
Hammond Vaidya. Address is 10870 Crane Highway, Faulkner, Maryland, 20632.
Okay, please have a seat.
And I do have a letter from Mr. Fender giving the Vaidyas and Mr. Martinez permission to speak on his behalf.
Okay. Village Liquors, so I can finish.
Sorry.
Pursuant to Section 6-204, the Alcoholic Beverage Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County wishes to make inquiry into the following. Clarification of correct license for business operating license premises, to wit, Class D-BWL license issued for licensed premise as a bar, although the health department has not issued a permit for a bar.
So if I could take over briefly, we were here last month and you were going to get an update. So Mr. Martinez, if you could kind of bring us up to date on where we're at with getting a health permit.
Sure, Mr. Navage. For the record, David Martinez and Jenkins Law Firm on behalf of the licensees. As Mr. Navage indicated, we were here on this discussion last month about the licensing, the on-sale consumption, etc. At that time, the board had agreed to allow on-sale consumption of the beer only up until this hearing date. Pursuant to my conversation with Mr. Navage, I indicated, based on the legal discussion, that the licensee, Ms. Vaidya and Mr. Hemet Vaidya, will be put on the record today that they will not allow any alcohol to be consumed on the premises until the issuance of the health department permit. Subsequent to the hearing last month, my client had to amend their health department permit application. They had submitted the application for the license that had previously held. But there's a different classification for the bar, for the tavern. They've submitted that. I don't know whether Mr. Morris has provided that application to Ms. Hildebrandt. The health department inspector will be coming back out December 4th, so I'd be requesting to the board, pursuant to my conversation with Mr. Navage, for 60 days from today's date to obtain that health department permit, or whenever the health department, up until that time, when the health department permit is received, we'd submit that to Ms. Hildebrandt. And then my clients would be able to allow the on-sale consumption of the alcohol. So that's the status, Mr. Savage.
So in the meantime, we're all on the same page. The licensees agree there will be no sales on the premises, no consumption of, or I should say, no consumption of alcohol on the premises.
That's correct. And if you would, I would like to put on the record, you could question, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Vieti as to that point, or I can ask them the question to put on the record, but you've heard the representation I've made to the board and the confirmation from the county attorney for the board, and each of you need to answer individually, but you will not, you understand that you cannot allow alcohol to be consumed on the premises until the health department permit has been issued, and you're not going to let somebody consume alcohol on the premises, and if you do, it could be a condition of violation of the license. Yes. You understand that, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, you understand that? Okay, thank you.
So I think what we're asking, or what I would recommend to the board, and what I think you and I spoke about, is that we put this back on for inquiry on the January meeting, and that gives you, you expect, if all goes well, to get the health permit sometime in December. So that if you get the permit before that, we could, and it's handed over to Ms. Hillebrand, it can be taken off the January meeting, but if you don't have the health permit, we need to be back here in January to see what's going on.
That's my understanding, Mr. Navage, based on our discussions, and that would be the request to the board. Obviously, it's in my client's best interest. He, you know, they're trying to get the health department permit as soon as possible so that they can, you know, serve alcohol on the premises, but that would be my understanding and my request.
60-day follow-up?
60-day follow-up.
60 days. My question is, are they still allowed off sales?
Yes.
Of alcohol?
Oh, yes.
Right?
They're
okay.
Essentially going to operate as a retail store for the next 60
okay.
days,
okay.
Which is half of their license. Mm-hmm. And we'll see what happens with the health permit. So we would I'd probably like the board to make a motion and vote on that, what we just discussed, though, as far as... In the meantime, approval for the licensees to operate essentially as a package store for the next 60 days until Ms. Hillebrand receives the health permit.
Health permits. Okay. Do y'all understand all that? Did you hear? Okay. Can I ask for a motion?
I'll make a motion that we grant... a 60-day on-sale only or off-sale only license for Village Liquors, Nalini H. Vaidya and Joseph W. Fender, pursuant to Section 6-204 of the Alcoholic Beverage Article of the Annotated Code of Maryland. The Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County wishes to make the inquiry into the following. Clarification of the correct license for business operating licensed premises, to wit, the Class D-BWL license issued for the licensed premises as a bar. The 60-day conditional off-sale portion of the license and contingent upon the health department approval for them to have on sale sales as a bar.
I would say, Mr. Board Member, we probably don't need all that other
right.
language in
okay.
there.
Okay.
I think the court can just go right to, or the board can go right to making a motion allowing them to continue operating under their
off sale
portion of their license. The on sale would essentially be suspended until we get the health.
Would you like me to reword the?
I think that might be a good idea.
Yeah, because when you first said it, you said we were issuing them a license. They already
right,
have
right,
license.
Right. That it be granted to Village Liquors, Nalia H. Vaidya and Joseph W. Fender, pursuant to Section 6-204 of the Alcoholic Beverage Board.
I don't think you need any of that.
That they are allowed to.
Continue the
off sale of alcoholic beverages for
of their license
and that for 60 days awaiting approval of the health department for them to operate
the
on sale of alcoholic beverages at their premises.
I think we got that. I mean, did we get that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, can I have a second?
I'll give a second.
Thank you, Beth.
Any discussion, please? No discussion. Okay, so sir, as you said, if the health department approves this before January, let Ms. Hildebrand know.
Certainly.
If not approved, then you're back on the agenda in January. Okay.
Thank you.
Call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion passed. Thank you.
Madam Chair, thank you for your courtesy.
Thank you.
Mr. Navage, Ms. Hildebrand, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. Next on my list is an application, please, for PAL Liquors and Gas.
Nope. I'm sorry. Do you want to do Hacienda first?
Go back up.
Oh, my apologies. That's right. They're here. Okay. I'm sorry.
Maria Ruiz is here. I'm sorry.
Okay. Next on the list, since they arrived here, is the extension of conditional approval, please, for Hacienda Los Gallobos, Maria Ruiz. Request an extension of conditional approval. Please come up to the microphone.
Mm-hmm. Could you please raise your right hand? Speak into the microphone, please, Mr. Ruiz. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Please state your name and address for the record.
My house address?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. My name is Maria Ruiz, and my address is 45460 Roofly Way, California, Maryland, 20619.
Okay. Thank
Very
you.
Good. Please have a seat.
Yeah, have a seat, please. Okay, Ms. Rose, explain to us why you need an extension, please.
Because we buy the building. The building is all old, and we need to put a new stuff in there. So now we're waiting for the plumber to fix some pipes under the building. And I called one plumber, and they say they're going to give me an estimate for that. I'm waiting 3 weeks for that and nothing. So I called to somebody else. And they say they were gonna do it. So before the inspection, we need everything ready.
Right.
So it's not ready yet.
How close do you feel you are?
We just need a plumber.
Okay, so do you
hopefully.
Yeah. So for your, you're asking for an extension. So you need 30 days, you need 90 days, or 120?
I think 90 days is better because we're planning to do everything by December, but we have my brother-in-law wedding in January the 7th, and we're traveling to Mexico and then coming back by the 11th, 10th, and we don't want open before that trip.
Right. So if you ask for 120 days, you do know that if you get it before then, in 60 days, then that's fine.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So we'll put a motion and extend it for 120 days.
Okay.
And hopefully you'll get everything done by then.
I tried to do before my trip, everything done.
Okay, may I ask for a motion, please?
I'll make a motion to approve the request for extension of conditional approval for 120 days of Hacienda Los
Guayabos
for Maria Ruiz.
Okay, can I have a second?
I second that.
Okay, any discussion? The board has any questions? Okay, may I call for a vote? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Oppose? Okay, good luck.
Good luck.
And hope you get it open before 120 days. Thank you.
Thank you. Hopefully the plumber do faster. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Bye, Maria.
Okay, next on our list is going to be application for PAL Liquors and Gas, which is the application of Barindar PAL Singh and Harold Starr to transfer PAL Liquors and Gas Stations, Strand and Strand LLC, Class A1 BWL license from Harold Starr, and continue to trade as PAL Liquors and Gas, Strand and Strand LLC, 25965 Point Lookout Road, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650.
You raise your right hands, please. Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalty of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Would you please step up to the microphone, state your full name and address, please?
Brinderpal Singh, 23248 Jennifer Court, Leonardtown, Maryland, 20650.
Harold Starr, 21433 Hillary Court, Lexington Park, Maryland.
Very good.
Okay.
Daniel Slade, I'm just the representative for the company.
Thank you. Y'all can come on up and have a seat, please. Okay. Would you like to tell us about the application, Mr.
Yes.
Slade?
Yes, Madam Chairman. Mr. Singh and Mr. Starr have been running Shran and Shran trading as Powell's Liquors for over 2 years now. Mr. Singh has just obtained St. Mary's County residency, so he has now been assigned the membership interest of the LLC. Mr. Starr is a authorized person of the LLC. We're just doing the transfer to add Mr. Singh's name onto the liquor license. He's taken all the proper courses, as Mr. Thompson can tell you, both the local and state courses, and they just want to continue with the business they've been operating for 2.5 years, approximately.
Everything okay?
Everything's fine. They're ready to go.
We've got copies of all the courses and everything.
Oh, yeah. They both, Mr. Starr and Mr. Singh, came to RAST class. And I believe we have alcohol awareness. They've had their alcohol. I mean, they've been operating under the law, so they both are already. He's ready to go. Nothing's changing.
Mr. Tavenage, any questions, sir?
No.
No? Okay. Can I ask for a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the application of Barinder Pal Singh and Harold Starr to transfer Pal Liquors and Gas Shran and Shran LLC Class A1 Beer Wine Liquor License from Harold Starr and continue to trade as Pell Liquors and Gas Station Gas, Strand and Strand LLC, 25965 Point Lookout Road, Hollywood, Maryland, 20650.
Leonardtown, Maryland. You said Hollywood.
Leonardtown.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, let's call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, approved.
Thank you.
Pal. Do you have your license with you by any chance? Okay, good. Take this over to the treasurer and the license and your checkbook and write her a check for $100 and you're good to go.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
On the line to sign. Thank you.
Excuse me.
Okay. Next on our list, we have a violation, please, for Boatman's Mini Mart, Helen C. Bush. Could you please step forward?
Could you raise your right hand, please? Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Okay, please step up to the microphone, step to the microphone, so speak directly into it, and say, state your name and address, please.
Okay. Helen C. Bush, 40575 Cavanaugh Road, Mechanicsville, Maryland, 20659.
Thank you, Ms. Bush. Please have a seat. Okay, Boatman's Mini Mart. Do you have a seat? Helen C. Bush.
Yes.
Commission of acts on licensed premises contrary to this state and or local law in violation of section 504B, acts contrary to law of the rules and regulations of the Alcohol Board of St. Mary's County, to wit, distribution of tobacco products in violation of section 1-1203 of the local government section of the Maryland Annotated Code. How do you plead?
Guilty.
Guilty?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Mr. Cavendish.
You understand the potential penalty is a fine.
Yes.
Or we could have a possible suspension or revocation, although it's not likely, but a fine is probably what you're looking at. You understand that, Ms. Bush? Because
yes.
You are the licensee, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. The facts of this violation occurred on October 13th, 2016. Corporal Stone of the St. Mary's Sheriff's Department and our alcohol board officer was conducting a tobacco compliance check countywide. He was working with a 16-year-old underage confidential informant. They went to Boatman's Mini Mart, located on Oakville Road in Mechanicsville here in St. Mary's County, which is a business that has a license under the liquor board here. The underage informant went into the store, made contact with the clerk, who was in fact Ms. Bush, asked to buy a pack of cigarettes. Ms. Bush completed the sale, gave the underage informant the cigarettes in exchange for money. The informant then left the store, made up contact with Corporal Stone, handed over the cigarettes. Corporal Stone then went in, made contact with Ms. Bush, identified her as the clerk who made the sale, and issued her a civil citation for selling alcohol or selling tobacco to a minor. The specific violation is a state law under 1-203, distribution of tobacco products. Person may not distribute tobacco product to a minor. And based on that there was a violation of a state law under the rules and regulations of the Alcohol Board 5-04B, no licensee or their agents or servants or employees shall commit or allow commission on the licensed premise of any act contrary to any state or local law. So that is the basic violation, selling cigarettes to a minor on the licensed premises.
Okay.
Ma'am, do you agree with that's what happened?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any questions about the facts of the case?
No.
Okay, Ms. Hildebrand, is this their first offense for this charge?
It's the first charge for cigarettes, but we do have on record an underage sale in December of 2014 for alcohol.
Okay.
Do we know, Ms. Hildebrand, do we know who in 2014 was the clerk at the time?
Who made the sale? I don't have those reports. I don't know if Purple Stone recalls.
It was a female, white female in 2014. I forget her name now, but she had sold two times in the past, but it's I don't think she had works there any longer.
That Ms. Bush, that individual is no longer in your employment?
Oh, I don't know which one you're talking about.
I'm sorry?
She wouldn't remember.
Don't remember?
I don't remember her name, and I don't have her name on record. But she wasn't the one who made the sale this time.
Right. I think you have the report right here. Let me bring it up real quick.
So we're going to treat this as a first offense for the cigarette, for that charge, and the other offense for alcohol is going to be separate, one and one.
Oh, she doesn't have an offense for alcohol.
No. 2014?
That was the alcohol offense, yes, but that's, you've already...
The employee's name back in 2014 was Ayla Kara?
Oh, yeah, that's, yeah, Al.
Is she still employed with you guys?
No.
Okay, so this is, that's for our agenda. I need a motion based on the testimony heard, please.
That the violation did occur?
No, she committed, she committed that, so, the guilt, so.
Just to clarify, we're talking about the penalty phase.
Right.
Correct.
I'll make a motion that we fine Boatman's Mini Mart, Helen C. Bush, $500, 250 suspended, 3 years probation for commission of acts of on licensed premises contrary to state and or local law in violation of section 504B acts contrary to law, the rules and regs of the Alcohol Beverage Board of St. Mary's County, to wit, distribution of tobacco products in violation of section 1-1203 of the local government section of the Maryland Antidote Code, based on the admittance of the guilt.
Madam Chairman, before you second that, or have that, we probably should ask Ms. Bush. Ms. Bush, is there anything you want to say to the board before they potentially make a motion on penalty?
No.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, I forgot that. Sorry.
That's okay.
And also to be paid within 10 business days. Defined.
What?
Defined to be paid within 10 business days.
Yeah, within 10 business days. Okay. Can I have a second on his motion, please?
I'll second it.
Ms. Curry seconds. Okay, is there any further discussion? Ms. Bush, the $500 fine suspended to $250 has to be paid to Ms. Hildebrand's office within 10 days.
Okay.
That has to be paid.
All right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
We need to vote on it first.
Yeah, we're going to vote now. All right. May I have a vote, please, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, it's been passed, the motion passed. Ms. Bush, the $250 has to be paid to Ms. Hildebrand's office.
Which one, this lady?
That's your alcohol office that's located at the other end of the county here, or Leonardtown.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Good luck. She need the address or anything, or
no,
she'll be okay?
No, she'll fine.
Okay. All right, next on our list here is I have special privileges applications, Wildwood Wine and Spirits, Runoc A. Shram, requesting a beer wine testing permit for 365 days per year.
Would you raise your right hand, please? Do you hereby declare and affirm under the penalties of perjury that the testimony you are about to give will be the truth and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Please state your name and your address for the record.
Runoc A. Sharma, 23576 Red Fox Way, California, Maryland 20619.
Please have a seat, please, sir. Okay, tell us a little bit about what you want to do.
If you want to have a wine and beer tasting, that we can do, we have planned to do it every weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, usually in the evenings, and that's what we are applying for this license.
All right. So, Ms. Hildebrand, does that start now to end at the end of the year, or does that go in through to next year?
It will start and end. These BWT, new BWT permits end when the license ends, April 30th. Any licensee who wants to continue it would renew it with their liquor license when they do their renewals. Ron is asking for the full year. He knows he doesn't have 365 days left, but he also, it would be easier for him to smoothly go through renewal and not have to come back to you and ask for the 365 at that time. And he does understand that, according to our regulations and what the board has decided, is even though it's a 365-day-a-year license, any product must be disposed of at the end of the business day. So nothing, we can't come in and find open containers that have been hanging around.
So clarification on that, Sillibrand, is that if they're doing wine tasting and they get halfway through the bottle and serving people that want to taste that particular variety, then whatever's left over must be disposed of.
Correct. Cannot be left, for the next day for another tasting. Okay. Or sold off.
What did you say?
Or sold. Can't sell a partial bottle.
Discount price.
Nope.
But I still there drink it.
Yeah.
Okay. Is there, do I ask if there's any protests from the audience or anything?
Not
like
for
that?
This.
Not for that?
Not
okay.
For this. He already has a license.
All right. Can I have a motion, please, by the board?
I make a motion that we approve the special privilege application for Wildwood Wine and Spirits, Mr. Ronick A. Sharma, for beer wine tasting permit for 365 days per year.
Okay, but his ends in April 2017.
That's automatic.
Based on that. Okay.
That's automatic. Ends with his license.
All right, do I have a second?
I'll second. Kevin?
Okay, any discussion? Anybody want to discuss this at all?
How many times do you think you'll do it, a week or?
Usually plan to do Thursday, Friday, Saturday. That's the plan right now.
What is that again, Mr. Sharma?
I want to do it on Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Thursday, Friday, and Saturdays. Is that going to be every week then?
Depends on, I would like some salesmen, how it works out with, they would come and do the test.
So you talk to your sales distributors?
Depends who is available, how is available. Sometimes I might not do it some weekends. You know, it all depends how they are available to come at my store and do the test.
So Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday?
Don't plan to do on Sunday. Usually those are the...
Are you open 7 days a week?
Yeah, I'm open 7 days a week. Yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, this license do provide me to do every
right,
day,
do it any day,
but
any
I do
day.
Not plan to
right,
do
right.
it.
Right. But you don't think on Sundays then? Right?
No.
Okay, can I call for a vote? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thank you.
Good luck.
Here, Ron. And you're going to have to, they're going to put that, you have your license with you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, just bring it over there with that and they'll fix it. All right.
Thank you.
Take care.
This one here. Mm-hmm. The name, Addie. I'm related. So I need
you,
to recuse
you,
myself.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next on the agenda, I have an officer member trade name changes. Wicomico Shores Municipal Golf Course, Addie Nicholas H. Isom.
Madam Chairman, I have to recuse myself as being related to Nicholas Isom.
Okay.
Is he here?
No, you don't have to be here.
That's just a name change.
Oh, just a name change.
I'll make the motion that we add Nicholas H. Isom to the Wicomico Shores Municipal Golf Course.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
Any second? Any discussion? Call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Can't vote.
Let him
can't
vote.
Motion in.
Mine doesn't count.
Right. Okay, that's settled. Now we're going into other business.
Just for signature.
Yeah, just for Linda's signature. Thank you.
Signature and title.
All right, next on the agenda is we'd like to hear from our board administrator, Tammy Hildebrand.
First off, Mrs. Palczynski, I've given you a copy of the MOU that we have with the sheriff. The MOU basically is between the Alcohol Beverage Board and the sheriff's office, giving us a full-time deputy to act as alcohol enforcement coordinator. We have not changed the wording of that in many years. I think the sheriff made an alteration to it a few years back, so that wording is still the same. It's basically we need a motion that the board wants to continue the MOU for the alcohol enforcement coordinator. And then we will forward that to the sheriff and see if he will sign off on it. I just want to make mention that Article 2B, or the alcohol beverages article, does have in law that we are required to have a inspector with peace officer powers, which is our alcohol enforcement coordinator. So it is required by law on our end. So.
Okay. So we need a motion to vote on.
Correct.
Yes. Okay, I need a motion, please, to vote on that we keep our officer for our MOU with the state. With the sheriff's department. May I have a motion?
I make a motion that we keep the agreement we have with the sheriff's department for the MOU.
All right. Can I have a second?
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
Yes. Will it always be Colonel Stone, Corporal Stone?
What's that?
Will it always be you?
Well, you know, he keeps trying to get away. We keep driving him back.
At this point,
as far as I know, I'm yours until they say I'm not. So,
Corporal Stone, that's up to the pleasure of the sheriff, correct?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, can I call for a vote? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, motion stands. We will turn this into our sheriff.
Thank you. The other item on the agenda is the FY18 budget. It's budget time. I need you to sign both. Yes, please. I had originally last year's budget, and for the new board members, we had a grant that fully funded our RAS Tipsy Taxi program. That grant expired September 30th, 2016. So for the FY17 budget, we had to budget in 3/4 of the cost of the program into our budget. So one change I will have to make on the 2018 is to include that final 4/4, because there is no grant funding for 2018 at all. Okay. So that will be a slight increase. I believe when I did the math, it was about $1,800, $1,900. Okay. We're cheap. All right. We'll see how that goes, given that we are attempting now to do RAS trainings every month. We have one at the end of this month, the 29th at 1 o'clock. Corporal Stone, Garland, and myself will be training that. And we did that for a lot of the new licensees that are coming on, are getting trained. Most of them are doing it ahead of time. Even some licensees who have already been on the license and a new licensee is coming on to do the training, those licensees are the licensees who aren't required, because you know they've been grandfathered in, so to speak, we're kind of encouraging them to come in, and they are. So we haven't had a bad review yet. People like the program. They get a lot of information out of it, helpful information, and I think we're doing very well with it. So it's working. Of course, now it's law. So that will be one slight increase in the budget. I had thought that would be the only increase, but we do have some issues have come up in the past, and we were doing this incorrectly when I was part-time and renewal time. You know, our assistant is a 20-hour a week employee. In order to comply with federal FSLA regulations, any hours, you know, it used to be if I went over my hours, my 20 hours to help Patsy out, extra help if she was away, or extra help during renewal time, I could comp anything over the 20, because we only have in our budget, we only budget 20 hours for that position a week. Okay. However, that was wrong a apparently in the accounting. FSLA says that you can only issue comp or overtime when somebody has worked 40 hours in the work week. Over 40 hours in the work week. So the only way to rectify that is either, in order to stay into budget, is either Susie, you know, that position works 40 hours 1 week of the pay period and then doesn't work the next week of the pay period, which doesn't help the office, okay? Or whatever extra hours she works throughout the year, I don't know, what I say, after Thanksgiving, go home and you're not getting paid? you know, I mean, there's no way of doing this without increasing the budget. So I would like to board's permission to sit down with Susie and look at our past calendar and see when we have needed her extra hours. It's at least the last 2 weeks of renewal. You know, that gets crazy. Well, look, I always give you guys a breakdown how many people come in every day. We're going to look at that breakdown. It suddenly becomes a tool for this, not just Tammy having a number crunching fun day, right? We'll try and see about the hours. But then also in discussion, we have some, and when Dave comes up from the Beverage Association, he'll probably discuss this more, that there are some specialty licenses, bills going up for specialty licenses this legislative session. And we've talked in the office that this entails more paperwork, more inspections, you know, more enforcement, depending on how many people want these licenses. It's an increase in our workload. So I don't know if possibly we just increase the assistance hours. We may need to, I don't know if, you know, I mean, we have to look at the inspector's position as well, you know. And of course that won't go in, that will, if any new legislation comes on board and it is passed, it will go in effect July 1, which is the beginning of the 2018 year. I don't have a crystal ball to see if these things are going to get passed or not. So it's kind of a, do we do that now or do we make a budget amendment afterwards? So guidance, and I mean, at this point, I think I need to at least look at how many hours I do need an assistant extra at the office during renewal time. Things have changed in this office. You know, Patsy used to do it by herself for 30 some odd years. She did it by herself. Things are growing in the county, obviously. Laws are changing. We're a little more dynamic in the office with what we do. Miss Wilden actually has her own set of things that she follows, alcohol awareness, where she's also now gotten to where she's calling up these trainers and these companies that are not following Maryland law and calling them to task. So we're getting a little more, you know, with our RAST program and everything and interaction with the licensees. So it's becoming a little more intense. And it's a good thing. It's good for the county. It's good for the licensees, I think. You know, we're providing a good service. So I think I will try and review that to the best of my ability and put that on the budget that I give to you at January's meeting. I will try and scrape something together for December as a draft that you can just kind of look at and question me on. But at this point, I just need to know if, you know, your feelings about that. And also if you have other suggestions for the budget, if there are things that maybe you guys want to see, if we have increases or whatnot. So.
Is this something you want us to think over, then bring to the next meeting? Or?
Well, I'm going to bring you, I'm going to attempt to bring you a draft for the December meeting. It's going to be a very rough draft because finance doesn't have all the numbers that they normally give us because normally budgets have to be to them in February, but you meet before, you meet after the budget is due, so I have to always get it to you in January, at the January meeting. So I'd like to bring a draft next month so you can look at it. But at this point, if you're okay with me figuring in these hours at this point, and I'll put them in, and then you can, you know, make your decision at the, you know, you can ask questions at December and then make your final decision in January. Because basically what I bring you in January has to be signed off in January, approved or, you know, because it has to go upstairs to Finance at that time. We don't have another meeting beyond that. So if you have suggestions or advice or commentary, right now would even be, you know, if you have questions for me or.
I mean, I think you do have to go through and figure out the hours for Susie that you need.
Yeah.
The week you go on vacation or whatever, if she's extra
right.
hours then. And
right.
Like, right. Yeah.
Right. Because, yeah.
Ms. Wilderness is just 20 hours.
That's all we're budgeted for.
That's all we're budgeted for there.
Yes.
Okay. And anything above and beyond the 20 hours cannot be comped, correct?
Not unless she goes over 40.
Unless she goes over 40.
Mm-hmm.
Is there...
And we do not have that in our budget.
Is there... Can you compute what it would be if Ms. Weldon would be a full-time employee?
Yeah.
And would that be something that Ms. Weldon would want to do?
Well, that's the other question.
You know, the other question, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And will the commissioner sign off on a
and
on a
right,
full
exactly.
FTE?
But,
right.
I mean, if there's a workload consideration here
mm-hmm.
to effectively run this office, you know, that there is a need for another full-time employee. But then again, you've got the benefits package and
it's a
everything
big,
else
right.
included also, which,
right.
which is there a way to at least look at that
mm-hmm.
for consideration, you
sure.
know?
Sure.
Because obviously Ms. Weldon should be compensated for
right.
the
Absolutely.
Time, you know, that
Absolutely.
Goes,
sure.
you know, but I don't want to see
well,
where she's in a pay period where she puts in 30 hours and doesn't, you know, there's no way to compensate her for it.
Well, we pay her those 30 hours, but then she can only work 10 hours the following week.
The following, yeah, right, exactly.
Which doesn't help the office.
Tammy has her
ass
training and she's
right.
out that day
right,
in
right,
another
right.
meeting or
right.
something and needs
what,
her for a couple days.
What are you typically granted as far as vacation for full-time
employees? We earn vacation by hour. It's a percentage of how many hours you work.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
okay. But obviously you like to take vacations, correct?
I usually take, I usually don't take more than 1 week a year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'll grab a day here and there because, you know, I just, you know, I mean, this past year I went away for 1 week. And I usually try and, because we have deadlines, we have RAS classes, so, you know, you got to kind of squeeze it in. I also had a second job that I had obligations, so I couldn't leave town. Now I'm down to one job, this one. So
thank goodness.
I might have a little more wiggle room for more time off, but you know, if you ask me how much I've got racked up, I've got a lot racked up.
Well, my question being there, then, as far as RAS training,
mm-hmm.
that would be either yourself or Corporal Stone, or both
the
of you
three
together?
Of us do training.
All three of you right
there's three,
there, right?
There's three segments
and,
to the
and
training.
And we're doing this once a month. I
mm-hmm.
mean, perhaps that's something that...
Well, we usually
you know,
do, and we've scheduled it on a day that Susie normally works, or I could say we've had her schedule that she works on that day.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But
so
I mean,
she is there to cover
you know,
the office.
That becomes
but,
labor intensive there.
Yeah, right? There's the other side of that. Well, you know, if we do an on-site RAS training that happens to fall on the weekend. I either have to cut those hours out of my during the week or I comp. So, but I have the ability to comp because I am a 40-hour employee. So it doesn't cost the county necessarily more money. It's just my hours, you know. But yeah, I can look into...
excuse me, Tammy,
yeah.
you're salaried but not exempt, correct?
I'm not salaried.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, I have benefit.
Yeah.
I've, you
yeah.
know.
That's what I meant.
Okay. So yeah, I can look into an increase in the hours. I'll discuss that with Ms. Wilden if that's something that even she wants to do. We'll work up a couple scenarios and we'll call HR and finance and see what the numbers would be. And you know it. We can ask for Christmas. We can ask for you know the Christmas, and you know the commissioners can always shoot it down, and then maybe we can go back and just say okay, you know. But we'll put something. I'll put a couple scenarios together for you next month. Okay.
All right. Next. Our alcohol enforcement coordinator, Corporal James Stone.
So in the month of October, there was one person issued a citation for consuming alcohol under the age of 21. There was 17 DUIs that occurred in St. Mary's County through St. Mary's County Sheriff's Office. Of those 17 DUIs, they're all adults above the age over 21. So we didn't get anybody under the age of 21. Did checks at various bars, retail establishments, and parks, and I had one violation that occurred during that time frame. And you guys heard that today. And last month, myself, Tammy, and Garland, as she explained, we did responsible alcohol service training. We initially did one October 1st at the Moose Lodge in Mechanicsville for members of the Moose Lodge. So we did on-site training there. And then on October 25th, we did one at the Patuxent Building, the Governmental Center, where we had a pretty good turnout there as well. And not much else going on. I've been nominated to be a co-chair for the Tobacco Free Living Behavioral Health Team. So getting more involved in the tobacco portion of things in the community, which is very important in my mind. It helps reduce people with substance abuse problems over time. People who chew or smoke tobacco at a younger age are more likely to gain addiction to alcohol and drugs in the future. So it's really important to try to reduce that from happening and occurring. And trying to think what else. After the alcohol board hearing last month, I did compliance checks for tobacco. I checked 30 establishments. Out of 30 establishments, four sold to people underage. One business had a liquor license. So I was really glad with the amount of businesses that didn't sell. I mean, we were at nearly 50% rating of sales occurring with tobacco last year, and we're down to about 10% right now. So that's really good. And
do you want to just review for Mr. Cole's benefit and maybe Mr. Belvine's when he reviews the meeting? Because continuing members know why we're bringing them tobacco violations.
So it became a question of when people check IDs, the responsibility is checking the IDs, knowing the age, the date of birth of people to sell tobacco to. But when it goes beyond that point of you have the responsibility of selling tobacco to individuals, it's still a substance, it's a controlled substance. And a concern that through discussions with the coalitions and the health department is if people don't have the ability to check IDs for tobacco and also hold a liquor license, that is still a concern that are they checking the ID from what alcohol is being sold to. So there's a combination of both. If you're lax on the tobacco part, then you're possibly going to be lax on selling the alcohol portion of it as well. So the best thing to do is be consistent. Same thing, philosophy is checking IDs 100% within businesses. If you check IDs 100% of the time, you're most likely not going to sell to somebody underage, as long as you know how to check the date of birth and know where to look for the, I mean, IDs have the information on there. It tells you what the age is, when they turn 21, and it can't get any easier than that. When it comes to fraudulent IDs, it gets more complicated for the alcohol portion of the business because they have to do a little extra legwork into checking the ID. But I'm very confident with the community. Like today, you guys had the Community Alcohol Coalition come in with the Licensed Beverage Association and for responsible business owners doing the right thing and not having violations because they're doing everything they're supposed to do. So I'm really proud with the way St. Mary's has. I think that St. Mary's County is a gold standard when it comes to responsible businesses. And occasionally there's some that slip through the cracks, but, you know, we always try to work with them. That makes sense.
Corporal Stone, you're not, businesses are not allowed to seize a license, correct?
A business, if they believe that it's a fraudulent ID, is what you're saying? Or
underage, either or?
If they're underage, technically it's still the property of the person who bared the ID, so technically you can't confiscate that ID from them. But if you do think that it is somebody that's of underage, you have the right to write down all the information or contact the police department. There's a misrepresentation of age.
So there's a whole protocol
When we go through RAS training, we explain the process of if you come across an ID and you think it's fraudulent, this is what you do. And a lot of times when business owners say, I believe this is a fraudulent ID, I'm going to contact the sheriff's department or I'm going to fill out the information for the sheriff's department. As soon as they hear sheriff's department or police, they leave the ID and they separate themselves as much as they can from the property. Mm-hmm. So, but again, going through training, educating businesses educating their employees becomes very successful in reducing the availability of tobacco and alcohol to underage.
I just had two other questions for you. One is that, and what I have recused myself on the member for Wicomico Shores, Nicholas Isom, will he need then to be RAS trained?
He has already been.
Oh, he has already?
Yep.
Okay. The other thing, Corporal Stone, is are you now with collateral duties with the Lexington Park Cops Unit?
My supervisor is Sergeant Clay Safford, who's in charge of the Cops Unit. Through my monthly duties, I participate in some activities in Lexington Park to enforce goals of the Cops Unit, as well as within the community. But yes, occasionally I do go work with them, and I work well with all those guys as well.
But that's just simply collateral duties, so quote unquote.
Yeah, but it's also built into my job description and duties too. So
very good.
And it's good working with other people, because for the longest time working in alcohol enforcement is an isolating position too. So
right.
It's nice to be a part of a group.
Get bored with us.
Now that the cops unit down there is just. I know them all personally. They're just outstanding.
Yeah, a great group of guys.
Group of. Men and women.
Yep. So, okay. And I guess last but not least, I guess since it's televised, is Corporal Peggy Smolarski of the Sheriff's Office retires this month. And she was my field training officer when I first became a police officer. And she was a very good person to me. And I'm definitely going to miss her. If you guys are in Leonardtown, you know the Leonardtown Community Police Officer. She's the Leonardtown Community Police, and she's done a fantastic job building the relationship between police and the community of Leonardtown. And she goes outside Leonardtown, and she goes above and beyond. She helps people in their need. She finds resources for people. She's giving people clothing. I mean, there's all sorts of things Peggy's done. And, you know, so if you guys get a chance for the Veterans Day Parade tomorrow, and you see Peggy, if you guys are there, definitely go up and thank her for her service. And, you know, it's one leading up to the last week of work for her. So.
Very good.
Very good. Yeah.
Thank you. Job well done. Next, Board Inspector Garland Thompson.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Well, besides that, for the very first month that we are preparing paperwork for the board members doing some of the violations that I found. Also did the completing the 5,000 miles checkup on our ABB vehicle that we have. I do inspections with, and I'm keeping it up through the county, inspected and keeping up with the maintenance. Contacted licensees about their signage, of course, and also things that they are need with non-compliance. I talked to them about. And I performed also my part of the RAS training that we had on October 25th. So for the month, I did 15 inspections and also performed 6 follow-ups for the month on top of that.
Good job. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Okay, next on my list is the St. Mary's Licensed Beverage Association. Mr. Dent, welcome.
Good afternoon, everybody. David Dent on behalf of the St. Mary's County Licensed Beverage Association. Before I sit down and talk with you about a few things, what I'd like to do is Mr. Cole just asked about fake IDs, fraudulent IDs. We just had one of our members actually racing in as a member that received one of the awards today, had a customer leave a fraudulent ID at their premises. So I wanted to give this to Corporal Stone.
Very good.
Very good.
And I just wanted to interject too. That's part of why we we've started giving the responsible retailers award to some of our businesses that do practice better business practices. Racing In has collected a few fraudulent IDs. To answer your question, Mr. Cole, we can't confiscate them, but if the person leaves it behind, we turn them into the sheriff's office.
Do you all have like a standard form that's there at the, or may I suggest that if you don't have it, that something be developed?
Yes, sir, we
pull
do.
Out and
we, the form that it, I gave, the envelope okay, that I gave okay. him actually has a form on it
okay,
that the clerk
great.
Fills
that's
out
great.
With the, yeah. sort of, I guess, like a chain of evidence to mm-hmm. when they collected it, who collected it, what the person looked like, that kind of thing.
Okay.
So it was, I'm glad you asked that question because that sort of just fit right into what I was going to present.
Because, yeah, I think that, that was the person that's using the underage ID and everything else, like Corporal Stone says, they try and distance themselves real quick.
Exactly.
You know, that's excellent.
And with that, the sheriff's office can pursue the person who tried to present it in a case where one was not confiscated, one was held at my business. We were able to prosecute the minor that had attempted to use it. So it's a very good tool to get the information out that it's not acceptable to even attempt to use a fraudulent ID.
Do you know what the penalty is for that? I mean, the max, and I guess it would come down from there?
We've actually been talking about this with Corporal Stone, and Corporal Stone has made some inquiries with the state's attorney. Mm-hmm. And our organization, Licensed Beverage Association, is going to hopefully work with a member of the state's attorney's office to come up with sort of like a matrix like we did for the liquor board, mm-hmm. where, you know, we could suggest an outline of the penalties. So anybody that's underage will know exactly what will occur to, the, you know, what will happen to them.
Well, I would seriously think that would be a deterrent
yes,
if
sir.
There was some kind of sticker that was produced, you know, that could go on the door where it says, you know, we ID everybody or whatever.
Right.
You know, and if you're caught, then it's so much, you know, could be up to or, you know.
Right.
Kind of thing. So to curb that underage drinking, I mean.
Our association think that's a very important part of the whole atmosphere of trying to stop underage sales is, you know, to create the culture where the people understand if they do attempt to use a fraudulent ID, that there are consequences and they will be dealt with.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, on one side we have the businesses trying to be responsible. On the other side we have warnings going out to anybody that might be underage, warning them not to use it because there are serious consequences. Mm-hmm. And we think the combination of those two help the goals of the Community Alcohol Coalition, the Liquor Board, and the Licensed Beverage Association. So it's something we work very hard on.
Yeah, and I certainly think that all of this can be tied together with, you know, drinking and driving, underage drinking, texting while driving, you know, all of this, you know.
Yes, sir.
Bad behavior that needs to be tapped down.
Yes, sir, we agree. Okay, with that being said, I do have a couple other things that I'd like to speak with you about. One is I've come to find out the comptroller is going to hold a meeting where he tries to bring together the stakeholders in the alcohol business, including the county boards, the licensed beverage boards. I'm going to include representatives from the Wholesalers Association, the Liquor Wholesalers, the Beer Wholesalers Associations, as well as the Retail Association. They're having a panel discussions in the morning, and then in the afternoon they're going to meet with the various boards that appear, or the representatives from the boards that appear. So we think that's a very positive step to try to get everybody in the entire three-tier system, including the people that regulate us, together with the comptroller, who is the ultimate regulator for the alcohol business in the state, and have conversations about how we can all work together better and just to make sure everybody's on the same page. So we're excited about that. That's coming up
December 6th.
December 6th, I think it is, in Annapolis.
Yeah.
So I would encourage if any of the board members, if you haven't heard about it yet, if you're able to attend, I think it'd be very informative, if, you know, a good way to learn a little bit more about the industry and some of the current current problems and some of the current successes that we're having as an industry. The final topic I wanted to talk about is, Tammy alluded to it earlier, Deb Bray, our delegate from St. Mary's County, has contacted us and is working with the town of Leonardtown to pursue some specialty licenses. One is a beauty salon license and the other is an arts and entertainment license. I'm not sure if you guys know exactly what's being proposed, but I would encourage you to maybe contact Delegate Ray to find out what's going on in concerning that. I was involved with a meeting with the town of Leonard, some representatives from the town of Leonardtown, and Delegate Ray, some of the delegation was there, just speaking about a specialty license basically for allowing beauty salons to serve beer and wine, and also a separate specialty license for arts and entertainment license that would allow anybody in that industry to also serve beer and wine. So I would just like to, I know that it's going to come up at the joint commissioner delegation meeting that they have every year, that's in December as well. I'm not sure of the date on that. But I think perhaps the board ought to try to find out a little bit more about that and make sure that it's something, and just give input one way or the other on, you know, what the board's feeling on that is. Obviously, the Licensed Beverage Association opinion is that if you're not in a traditional hospitality industry, we don't feel that you should be issued a license. You know, it should be left to the alcohol industry or the hospitality industry, hotels, restaurants, bars, things like that, package stores. So just making sure that you guys were aware of that was going on, and if you had any information, perhaps you should, or any questions, you could contact Delegate Ray's office and find out what the status of that legislation is.
So the association would be against these specialty licenses?
Yes, sir. We were fortunate that Delegate Ray included us in the conversations, you know, trying to come to a consensus. And we gave a little bit of input, you know, if the licenses were to be approved and issued, you know, some of the things we would like to see in the law. But our position is we don't feel that they should be issued, specialty license shouldn't be issued. But, you know, we were lucky enough to be at least be included in the conversation of what if they were passed.
And we've talked about it before. Does it stop?
Yes, sir.
That's, you know. You know, which business will it stop from? It would not just beauty salons, and you know, everybody could be asking for them.
It's the same conversation we had at the last meeting, the meeting before, with the vapor shops. You know, how many industries do we want to include to have a liquor license? Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to make sure the board was aware that there was legislation being circulated, and you know, try to find out what's going on with that, and you know, just be able to be informed on what's happening.
Did the delegates, because I have sent you the proposals that Delegate Ray had brought to my office. That goes to me. Yeah. Thank you. and I thought between the conversations that were being had that some of those proposals might be changed a bit. Do we know if there were any changes made?
I know what there were some changes discussed at the meeting, but I haven't seen a formal end product yet.
Did Delegate Ray state that she would release this if changes are made, if she was going to release? Because I haven't heard back from her in regards to that. I mean, I guess I should contact her and ask. But
as far as I know, that she plans on presenting the legislation at the delegation, the joint meeting.
Okay.
I'm not sure other than that when the, you know, proposed legislation would be discussed. I just know it would be discussed that day.
Okay.
I would think that she would have a draft of a proposal anyway prepared before then for observation, but I really don't know for sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So just to quickly step on Dave's time here, just so you know, I mean, a lot of times and actually frequently, any kind of legislation has always come before you guys kind of looking for your support, but realize that legislation can go up with or without your support. Okay.
And I think that's all I have today, unless there's any questions for me. Okay, thank you for your time today. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, adjourned, right?
No, CAC.
Oh, sorry. The Community Alcohol Coalition.
Hi, guys.
Hey, Lauren.
My name is Lauren Abel. For those who don't know me, I'm the coordinator of the Community Alcohol Coalition. First of all, thank you guys for allowing us to present our awards today. And also, again, thank you to all the businesses that were eligible for that award and the work that they've been doing. Other than that, the only thing I have to say for this month is on the 16th, November 16th, the Alcohol Coalition, Officer Stone, and the Licensed Beverage Association will be hosting a free fraudulent ID training at Bay District Firehouse from 1 to 2 and then 7 to 8. We sent out letters to all the local businesses encouraging them to send employees to attend, so we hope we have a good turnout for that. The state team is coming to see me next week to get our strategic plan done, so hopefully things will be more productive as we move towards the new year, and I'll have more things to bring to you guys. But yeah, other than that, I appreciate it. Thank you all.
Will you Lauren, will you guys be having any kind of special campaigns for the holidays to help with designated driver programs and responsible alcohol consumption?
Right now, I think we have set that we hung up posters for Halloween. I don't know if you saw them around the community, but I think we will be sending out letters as well to businesses and alcohol retailers, as well as other businesses, to encourage them to be responsible in their Christmas parties, because that often seems to be an event where some DUIs can occur and stuff like that. So just a friendly reminder to be responsible. Probably similar to what we sent out last year, the same type of poster and letter combination. But yeah, that's what I foresee for right now. I'll let you know if anything changes.
Okay, thank you.
Right, thank you, guys.
Thank you, Lauren.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we adjourn, I'd like to remind everybody that tomorrow's Veterans Day, and we need to honor and respect our vets. And
don't forget,
just enjoy it.
Today is Miss Betty's birthday and the birthday of the Marine.
Happy birthday.
Me and the Marine.
Curry.
They're still older than I am. Thank you.
We all have those coming around once a year, I guess. Okay. Meeting adjourned, and I'll see everybody next month.
You need
Happy Thanksgiving.
You need a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
All right, there we go.